Another common clinical problem that affects women of all ages is a pelvic mass. We know that U.S. women have about a 5 to 10% lifetime risk of having surgery for an ovarian neoplasm. So we're going to spend just a few minutes talking about ovarian or pelvic masses. Of course, when we think about a pelvic mass, we're most concerned with ovarian cancer. And the most recent statistics that I have here is every year there's a little over somewhere between 21 and 22,000 cases of ovarian cancer. But what's so concerning is that there's such a high percentage of women with ovarian cancer that die from their ovarian cancer that you can see here. We do see an increase in ovarian cancer as women age, the incidence of ovarian cancer, with the mean age of diagnosis being 63. And another really kind of scary statistic is that there's been very little changes in the mortality rates or the survival rates since the 1950s. So our goal is to try to identify ovarian cancer before metastases have occurred so we can save women's lives, because that's one of the problems, is that ovarian cancer tends to be diagnosed very late in the course of the disease after metastasis has already occurred. So this is a little list of some of the masses that we're going to talk about just over the next few minutes. There are a number of risk factors for ovarian cancer that I have listed here, with age being the most important risk factor. And remember that most women with ovarian cancer do not have any risk factors at all, other than probably their age. When we talk about environmental factors, I just do want to mention that talcum powder has been associated with increasing the risk of ovarian cancer. I do want to say a couple things about the BRCA1 or BRCA2 gene mutations. Normally in our body, the BRCA1 and BRCA2 code for proteins that suppress tumor growth, suppress cell growth. And when you have a mutation in these specific genes, then you're not going to have this tumor suppressor, these tumor suppressor proteins, or you'll have a deficiency in these tumor suppressor proteins. Both of these mutations can increase the risk of not only breast cancer, but also ovarian cancer. As I mentioned, ovarian cancer has really few or no symptoms, so it's very difficult to make the diagnosis. Sometimes patients will have very vague digestive system symptoms that I have listed here. So if you have a patient who have these symptoms, you may want to refer them for further evaluation. How is ovarian cancer generally found? Just through regular health exams, such as ultrasounds, CT scans, MRI, may also be helpful, although those are generally not recommended at this point anyway for screening. The only screening test we do is the pelvic exam, that where you are palpating the ovaries. Although the pelvic exam has really limited ability to find an adnexal mass that's associated with cancer, especially if a patient has increased body weight, so they have increased fat tissue overlying their pelvic area, it makes it much more difficult. But it's the only screening test that we have right now. There are tumor markers. One is CA125. It's just a protein that increases with ovarian cancer, but unfortunately, it also increases with uterine fibroids, increases with endometriosis, so it's very nonspecific. It's probably more specific in postmenopausal women, but not in younger women. And then the gene. Many women are choosing, if they have this gene mutation, the BRCA gene, BRCA1 or BRCA2 gene mutation, they're going ahead and having a prophylactic oophorectomy. So one of my friends that I teach with at Emory Hospital, last Friday, her daughter had surgery for because she had tested positive for the BRCA1 and BRCA2, I can't remember which one of those genes. What's really interesting is that her father's sister had breast cancer and was tested for the BRCA mutation. And so her gene mutation came down through the paternal side of her family. So, you know, these gene mutations aren't just passed by women with breasts, but can be passed by men also. And so she was tested, his daughter, my friend's husband's daughter, their daughter, was tested, came back with positive mutation. So last Friday she had a bilateral mastectomy and reconstructive surgery and a bilateral oophorectomy at the same time. really tough surgery to go through. But she's doing, no cancer has been found in her breast, no cancer has been found in her ovaries. It's just prophylactic surgery. So this is just an ultrasound where we have an ovarian mass. This is a what we call a complex ovarian mass, and this is what you see most often with ovarian cancer. You know, many times you'll look at a cyst, and I think I may have some pictures of cysts. It will be just very black throughout the entire area, out in the entire cyst. But you see there's little, what we call septums in this mass, where you have little tissue kind of across the black area. That makes it a complex mass and makes it more likely to be ovarian. The other one next to it is a patient who has ascites. So they're looking in the abdominal cavity and they're able to see this fluid within the abdominal cavity. If a patient has ovarian cancer, they usually are going to have surgery, radiation, chemotherapy. Most often the chemotherapy now with ovarian cancer, instead of getting it in your blood, they're actually injecting the agent right into the pelvic cavity so that you have the local effect of the medication. It seems to be more effective. Or they may get it both through the blood and local injection. Now, if the ovarian cancer is found before metastasis has occurred, 9 of 10 patients will live longer than 5 years. So that's our goal through our careful evaluation of our patients. In general, though, 1 year survival rates are 78%. As you can see, 5 year survival rates are only 46%. Only about a quarter of ovarian cancers are found in the early stage. We do have some preventive methods. One is oral contraceptives. And again, we've known for, again, probably 30 or 40 years that oral contraceptives decrease the incidence of ovarian cancer. And the magnitude of protection is related to the duration of use. So if you took the pills for, if you're an ever user, you have a 40% decline in the risk for ovarian cancer. If you took them for longer than 10 years, you have a 90% decline in the risk for ovarian cancer. So that's really good news. And it probably also, these statistics probably also exist for the patch and the ring as well. We just don't have long-term data for those. Tubal ligation also has been associated with declining risk or declining levels of ovarian cancer. Really not certain, but it may have to do with blood flow to the ovaries that are interrupted somewhat when a tubal ligation is performed. Of course, hysterectomy with an oophorectomy. Pregnancy and breastfeeding also seem to be protective. Dietary recommendations, and now we don't have as good evidence to support this, but diets that are high in antioxidants have been associated with not just ovarian cancer, but cancer in general. And then avoiding asbestos and talc. I put a question mark because the evidence is a little weak with that, but it's certainly, I can tell you, I'm not using talcum powder as a way of preventing breast cancer. Okay, ovarian cancer. Moving on from ovarian cancer, remember that other uterine abnormalities, pregnancy, you have, a pelvic mass. You can have a uterine anomaly, as you see here on this picture. This is a patient that has a bicornate uterus. You know, instead of having just a normal fundus, they have kind of two separate areas of the uterus. So anytime you outline as you're doing your exam an asymmetrical uterus, you need to consider that the patient may have some genetic abnormality that has led to a uterine anomaly and a uterine fibroid or myomas. So let's talk a little bit more specifically about myomas. They're benign, a benign tumor of the uterus, and they come from the muscular component of the uterus as well as the connective tissues. We don't know why women develop these type of tumors, but it does seem to be related to hormones. Think of estrogen as being a growth hormone, and it causes these tumors to grow. So it can increase in pregnancy. In fact, it can grow so large that it causes problems with the pregnancy. It can lead to increase in spontaneous miscarriages, preterm labor, preterm deliveries. Can also cause complications. Patients can, as they grow, especially if it's a type of fibroid that's on a little stalk on the outside of the uterus. It grows, becomes so heavy, it becomes twisted, and that can be a surgical emergency because it's not getting the oxygen, not getting the blood flow and the oxygen that it needs. So very common, as you see here, every three women over the age of 35 has uterine fibroids. There's different types, so the different types are going to be associated with different symptoms. So if you have a submucous, meaning it's right under the endometrium, the most likely symptom the patient's going to experience is bleeding. If you have one that's on the outside of the uterus, it may grow to, you know, may put pressure on other organs. I had a friend who went to her physician because she was having urinary frequency and she thought she had a urinary tract infection. And they did a culture and a sensitivity and it came back negative, but they still had treated her empirically for a urinary tract infection. She was still having urinary frequency, so she went back, and even though the urine culture was and sensitivity were negative, they changed her antibiotic and gave her another antibiotic. Of course, she still continued with urinary frequency. Well, she went back the third time, and finally somebody did a pelvic exam. And when they found a pelvic exam, they found that her uterus was about a 12-week size and was this just huge uterine fibroid. And she had to have surgery to have it removed. So anytime that somebody comes in with urinary frequency, don't automatically think urinary tract infection. Keep in the back of your mind, she may have some large mass that's compressing her bladder. Pedunculated, that's the type of tumor that's on a little stalk that you see here, right up here, this part of the slide, this part of this type of myoma right here. So here we have submucous, here we have interstitial, here we have subserous, kind of right here under the serous layer on the uterus, and then here we have pedunculated. We also have one that's coming down here through the cervix. Now, the majority of those patients that have uterine fibroids don't have any symptoms at all, so most are symptom-free. But if they are going to have symptoms, the most common symptom is bleeding, that of bleeding, prolonged menses or heavy menses. And then I mentioned the pressure symptoms that patients may have. They can also put pressure on nerves, so they may have pain that goes into their back and down their legs because it's pressing on the sciatic nerve. Can also compress the ureters and lead to hydronephrosis, which can cause renal failure if it's not treated promptly. Some of the other complications, of course, when you have heavy blood loss, anemia, myomas can interfere with fertility, especially if it's compressing the fallopian tube, so it's going to prevent normal sperm transport to fertilize the egg. And then there's all sorts of pregnancy-related problems. And here is a patient has a large myoma right here, and here's the pregnancy right here. You can imagine this large uterine myoma may have an impact on the growth and development of the fetus. There's just not room for normal growth and development. Treatment. If the patient's having no symptoms or minimal symptoms, it's usually just going to be observation. You can use drug treatment. Where you see GnRH analogs that are being used, like Lupron, turning off the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis, essentially gets rid of estrogen, you'll see shrinkage of the fibroid tumors. And with that shrinkage, many times it'll be easier to remove it. Say a patient's trying to get pregnant and they can't get pregnant because of the fibroid tumor, so you remove it. But sometimes it's very difficult to remove the large one, so if you can shrink it, it makes it more easily removed. Sometimes patients also are approaching menopause, and if we can put off doing a hysterectomy, it's a good thing, because once they reach menopause and they have no estrogen, they just shrink all, you know, by themselves. Oral contraceptives do help to treat the bleeding associated with the myomas, but it doesn't really help to shrink the myomas that significantly. Surgery, the myomectomy where you just remove, as you see here, we have a patient where they're through the laparoscope, are just removing the fibroid itself, and then of course hysterectomy is the other option. Another treatment that is being done more frequently is uterine artery embolization. And I mentioned that in the earlier part of this presentation. And what they do is they inject through the femoral artery, or they take a catheter, pass it through the femoral artery up to the uterine artery and to the blood supply for the fibroid tumor, and they inject these little, what they call embospheres. They're polyvinyl chloride, little tiny microscopic balls, and it obstructs the blood supply, or part of the blood supply, to the fibroid tumor. And what happens as a result of that is that you have shrinkage of the fibroid tumor. It decreases the symptoms, decreases the bleeding associated with them. The procedure is associated with pain, quite a bit of pain for a day or two, a lot of cramping. And the complications are amenorrhea, which for many women that are choosing to have this procedure, you know, don't mind having amenorrhea, and the fibroids do slough. That can cause like a pelvic inflammatory disease type reaction. Okay, I just want to talk about some other non-ovarian and then ovarian masses very, very quickly. I don't want to spend a lot of time because most often, anytime we feel a mass, we're going to refer the patient for further evaluation. So non-ovarian ectopic pregnancy, what's the triad of symptoms? Missed period, followed by spotting, and pain. Anytime you have a patient, a reproductive age patient that has that triad of symptoms, you think ectopic. Could be an inflammatory process where you have a tubo-ovarian abscess, but usually you're going to have some type of history of an infectious process, chlamydia, gonorrhea, pelvic inflammatory disease. Sometimes you can just have normal physiologic enlargement of the ovary. Usually this is going to be around the time of ovulation. Sometimes patients will have ovarian cysts. The next slide will go into that in more detail. Usually, if the cyst is less than 7 centimeters, we may go ahead and evaluate with an ultrasound, but we're generally going to follow those patients and not do surgery right away. Most of the cysts, if they're a functional cyst, when I say functional, they're cysts that are occurring in a functioning ovary and they're part of the functioning ovary, spontaneously resolve, usually in 1 to 2 months. The three most common functional cysts are follicular cysts. These are follicles that just fail to ovulate and fail to regress, and they continue to produce estrogen, and they can become enlarged so that they cause symptoms. Pain is the primary symptom. A corpus luteum cyst, remember the corpus luteum is what's left over after ovulation, left over from the follicle after ovulation, continues to produce estrogen and progesterone, and it just doesn't degenerate. Usually they degenerate in 14 to 15 days, and it just, for some reason, refuses to degenerate. And again, bleeding, usually late heavy bleeding and pain is associated with a corpus luteum cyst. Fecal luteum cysts are more uncommon, and they're related to very high levels of HCG, the human chorionic gonadotropin, you know, the pregnancy hormone. So it's associated usually with pregnancies that are going to produce more or higher levels of HCG than normal. So you'll see it with multiple pregnancies, multiple gestations, twins, triplets, etc. Also, you'll see it with trophoblastic disease, like the hydatidiform mole. And you also will see this with ovulation induction. Fecal luteum cysts can become very large. They can be 10 centimeters in diameter. And then the pregnancy goes away, the baby's born, you get rid of the hydatidiform mole, and they just resolve spontaneously without having needing any surgery. These are some of the diagnostic procedures that may be utilized for helping to, you know, figure out what's going on with the pelvic mass. And also some things that can help to improve your pelvic exam techniques is make sure the bladder and the rectum are both empty before you do the pelvic exam. The patient needs to be relaxed, and it doesn't help to tell the patient to relax. If you tell somebody to relax, they automatically seem to tighten up. So, you know, give them some things that can help them to relax. You know, tell them to breathe deeply, you know, breathe in through their nose, blow it out through their mouth. You know, it's very difficult to tighten up your abdominal muscles if you're breathing in that format. And remember that a complete pelvic exam when you're evaluating a mass includes not only the vaginal exam, but the rectal exam as well, and the rectovaginal exam. Treatment of ovarian cysts most often is just observation. Patient doesn't need any intervention at all. May need some analgesics, you know, for the time that it takes the cyst to resolve. Combined oral contraceptives will not treat a cyst, but if I have a patient who's having frequent ovarian cysts, we'll help to prevent further ovarian cysts from developing. If I have patients that are having ovarian cysts, usually every month or every other month, I'm going to put them on some type of combined, meaning estrogen and progesterone hormonal contraception. If the cyst is usually greater than 7 centimeters in diameter, surgery is indicated. But I will tell you, anytime I feel an ovarian cyst or a pelvic abnormality, I will consult with my physician and usually get them to also do the pelvic exam with me. Some indications for surgical exploration, other than just being large, if you have a patient who's postmenopausal, essentially in a postmenopausal woman, you should not be able to feel the ovaries at all. And if you can feel the ovary, that's a sign that the ovary is enlarged. Anybody who has persistent ovarian enlargement, if you have a solid ovarian neoplasm, the only way that you can tell whether it's solid or not is through ultrasound. You know, so where ultrasound can say, yes, this is a cyst, no, this is a solid neoplasm. If you have bilateral ovarian neoplasms, excluding thecaludian cysts, that's more likely to be ovarian cancer. If there's any signs of torsion, and what we mean torsion is that just twisting, you know, so the ovary becomes enlarged, becomes heavy. Because of that enlargement, it twists. So you have decreased blood supply. That's going to lead to necrosis and gangrene. Or any unexplained ascites, of course, would be an indication. So just some other tips that may be helpful. If you have an adolescent who has some type of pelvic mass, think pregnancy. If it's less than 7 centimeters, follow unless the patient's having significant pain, which can indicate torsion that's present. During the reproductive years, 70% of cysts will resolve spontaneously without any type of intervention. And treat with oral contraceptives. This is kind of just the take-home messages here. Treat with oral contraceptives if the patient's having frequent cysts. If not going to help that cyst to resolve, but it may prevent further cyst development. Okay, the last problem that we're going to talk about, GYN problem that we're going to talk about, is that of amenorrhea. Now, I just want to mention that amenorrhea is not really a diagnosis in of itself. It's a symptom of some type of underlying problem. And so our goal is to make sure that we make the correct diagnosis before we start trying to treat amenorrhea. It's associated with an array of potential disorders or diseases. First of all, though, we have to define it, because missing one period is not amenorrhea. Not even missing two periods is amenorrhea. You have two specific definitions. One is a person who has never had a period. They've have absence or along with never having a period, they have absence or retardation of secondary sex characteristics. And this occurred by 14. But even if they have normal growth and development and they haven't had a period by age 16, that is considered to be amenorrhea. We have called it primary amenorrhea in the past. Say you have somebody who's been menstruating regularly and then they go for a total of 3 cycles or 6 months without a period, that is considered to be amenorrhea. The reason why I'm emphasizing this definition is that you don't want to start doing the workup, because it can be very expensive, before a patient actually meets this definition, they meet these criteria. There are some causes of physiologic amenorrhea, delayed puberty. You know, so here you have a patient who has no secondary sex characteristics. It may be that they just have a familial delayed puberty. So you ask, it's family history. You know, when did your dad start going through puberty? When did your mom start going through puberty? It may just be that they just genetically are programmed to start puberty at a later age. But if there's no secondary sex characteristics and they are 17, that's usually associated with a pathologic problem. That's not normal at all. Of course, it could be pregnancy, lactational amenorrhea. Remember, amenorrhea associated with breastfeeding doesn't necessarily indicate lack of fertility. Menopause, very common cause of amenorrhea. If it's less than 42 years of age, though, that's considered to be premature amenorrhea, and is associated with increase in heart disease and osteoporosis. Or it can be seen with hormonal contraception. Especially this day and age when we're using tiny doses, like pills that only have 10 micrograms of estrogen or 20 micrograms of estrogen, we're much more likely to have amenorrhea. I mean, we know that estrogen stimulates proliferation of the endometrium, and with these low doses of estrogen and the birth control pills, nothing proliferates. So when it's time to slough, there's nothing to slough, and the patient is amenorrheic. Actually, it's really healthy, it's really good. You know, remember, the only reason to have periods is if you want to become pregnant. When we think of amenorrhea, there's four discrete compartments that we need to evaluate very carefully, with compartment one being disorders of the outflow tract, like the vagina, making sure the vagina is present, the cervix is present, the uterus is present. Compartment two is problems with the ovary. Compartment three, problems with the pituitary, anterior pituitary gland. And compartment four, the central nervous system, primarily the hypothalamus. So, of course, again, we're always going to start off evaluating our patients with a good history and a good physical exam. And again, the history, I've just kind of highlighted some of the more important points that are necessary when evaluating somebody with amenorrhea, such as their exercise patterns. I mentioned that 19-year-old who's running 70 miles every week, they may, as a way of, you know, their body as a way of accommodating that, just shuts the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis completely down. If they have a history of growth and or developmental disorders from childhood, it may indicate that there's some other type of endocrine disorder that they're experiencing. Of course, stress. I see some of my students that are getting ready for a final exam week. You know, they may skip their period this month. That's really not amenorrhea, but realize that stress can interfere. If there's a family history of genetic anomalies, their nutritional status, we've talked about that with dysfunctional uterine bleeding, but patients can completely shut down if they have problems with anorexia or bulimia, specifically if they are associated with low body weight. And then other symptoms, such as nipple discharge, galactorrhea, we think pituitary tumor, hirsutism, we think PCOS, hot flashes, we think premature ovarian failure, or premature menopause. So, you know, the history is going to help to guide us, okay, what is going on with this patient. Physical examination may also be very helpful. I always tell my students that 85% of all diagnoses are made with a history and physical, and really only about 15% of the diagnoses will be made through laboratory studies. So laboratory studies are done frequently to help confirm the diagnosis, but you know, the bulk of the diagnoses is made just through the history and physical. So patients may have indications that they have some type of adrenal problem, that they have PCOS, that they have a pituitary tumor on the physical exam that indicates you know, that there's what the underlying problem may be. Now, I love dealing with amenorrhea because I'm very left brain, and it's a very step one, step two, step three mechanism. So it's, you know, I like being able to say I've crossed off step one, you know. So you have a patient who comes in, met the definition. The first thing that you're going to do is exclude pregnancy. Step one is exclude pregnancy. Go ahead and do a test TSH to make sure that hypothyroidism or hyperthyroidism isn't the underlying problem. Get a serum prolactin level, make sure a pituitary tumor is not the problem. But you also give what we call a progestational challenge, where we give Provera 10 milligrams a day for 5 days. So our goal here with this is to rule out pregnancy. We're also assessing the competency of the outflow tract, you know, making sure that there's, you know, everything is normal. And we're assessing, yes, estrogens are on board. In other words, estrogens have primed the endometrium, and as a result of giving the Provera, we should have withdrawal bleeding. So the result, if you have an elevated TSH, of course you have hypothyroidism. If you have an elevated serum prolactin, you have a compartment 3 disorder, you have a pituitary tumor. If you have positive withdrawal bleed with normal prolactin and normal TSH, your patient's anovulatory, and usually it's a central nervous system, a compartment 4 disorder. If they're bleeding, you know that their outflow tract is working well. If you have negative withdrawal bleed, either the target organ outflow tract, you know, is the problem, or you don't have any estrogen on board, so you may have an ovarian problem. So then you have to move to step 2. So if you have negative withdrawal bleed, you move to step 2. And here you cycle a patient with both estrogen and progesterone. And I've given you the doses here. If no withdrawal bleed, most endocrinologists would recommend try it again because it may take more than one cycle to actually stimulate the endometrium to proliferate. Our goal here is to assess the outflow tract. Now, if I have a patient who has already been menstruating regularly, I may skip this step and move to step 3. So if you have negative withdrawal bleed, you do have a disorder in the outflow tract, and we'll talk about that in just a second. So you have a positive withdrawal bleed with step 2, that means that you need to move to step 3. So we've ruled out, yes, we have a normal outflow tract, but we haven't ruled out other problems. You know, is the ovary an issue? You know, why did we have to move to step 2 to begin with? So now we're going to assess the FSH and LH levels. We want to know, is the problem with our pituitary or is the problem with our ovaries? And I've given you a little table here of normal FSH and LH levels. And then if they have low levels, which is hypogonadotropic, or elevated levels, which is hypergonadotropic. So if the patient has elevated FSH and LH, high gonadotropins, the most common cause for that is menopause. They may have premature ovarian failure. Remember, if they go through menopause less than age 42, that's premature. It may be due to an autoimmune disorder. It may be due because they were treated for radiation or chemotherapy, or destruction due to infection like mumps. Or they may have a tumor that produces gonadotropins. You can have an ovarian tumor that actually produces FSH and LH. Extremely rare. I've never seen something like that in my practice. If you have a patient under the age of 30 who is diagnosed with some problems with their ovary and ovarian dysfunction, you need to go ahead and do a karyotype, because sometimes those patients will have a Y in their karyotype, and that can increase the risk of having cancer of the gonads, and the gonads need to be removed. Now, if the results of step 3 are low or normal, that usually the next step is that you need to go ahead and get an MRI of the pituitary and make sure that the patient doesn't have a pituitary tumor. Or it can suggest hypothalamic, but you need to rule out pituitary tumor before you can say it's due to the hypothalamic, you know, the central nervous system. So really quickly, some of the disorders associated with the various compartments. So compartment 1, patient may have Asherman's syndrome. This is where you have severe adhesions. You can sometimes see this after surgery, like a DNC. Sometimes it can be after an infection, like pelvic inflammatory disease or endometritis, that results in these severe adhesions, severe scar tissue. You can have Mullerian anomalies. The Mullerian system is the upper portion of the vagina, the cervix, the uterus, and the fallopian tubes. So you can have an anomaly, such as an imperforate hymen. That you see here in this picture, where the hymen never, during the embryonic period, never developed the normal opening in the hymen, in the hymenal ring. That did not develop normally. You can have problems with just lapses in the continuity of the vagina. You can have absent cervix. Patients who have Mullerian agenesis means they don't have any of those organs. They have no upper portion of the vagina, no cervix, no uterus, no fallopian tubes. But they may have a little vaginal vault, you know, that makes it appear at birth that they have a normal vagina. And because of that, you don't look further at this point. In fact, you don't even know the patient has this problem, most likely, until they reach puberty and they don't start their menstrual cycles. So some patients will have XY chromosome, and they have androgen insensitivity. So what happens is that they produce normal levels of testosterone, but they have no receptors. Remember, when we think about how hormones work, they have to bind to receptors, and that turns on whatever activity needs to take place, such as the development of secondary sex characteristics or the development of penis and testicles. So these patients are XY, so they're male, but because of the testosterone that's needed to, for normal development is, can't work, they do not develop normal male characteristics. They're considered to be a male pseudo-hermaphrodite. That means they have XY chromosomes, but they don't have the genitalia of a male. What is interesting is that they also do not have the Müllerian system. So they have a ability to produce a protein called anti-Müllerian hormone, or a hormone, anti-Müllerian hormone, that blocks the development of the uterus and the fallopian tubes and the cervix, etc. What is really interesting is that these patients tend to also develop at puberty large breasts, because in males, estrogen is produced, but the testosterone is produced in such higher quantities that the testosterone dominates. Well, if you have a patient where testosterone cannot work, that means the estrogen content is going to dominate. And so sometimes these patients will have actually very large pendulous breasts because of their estrogen levels. So then at puberty, they don't they don't begin menstruation, and we start doing diagnostic tests that say they are XY. It's kind of the rare condition, but I've had, when I lecture on this in my to my graduate students, I've had two patients in the last year that have come up and told me that they actually have this disorder. Compartment 2 disorders, the most common is gonadal dysgenesis. That means that there's a little bit of ovary present, but it's not normal. They just have a little slice of ovary. So they don't produce normal hormonal levels. That's the number one cause of primary amenorrhea that you see in the adolescent. Turner syndrome is another problem with the ovary, where you're missing one X. Instead of being 46XX, you're 45X. So that's a genetic disorder. Mosaicism goes along with Turner syndrome. When you have mosaicism, that means that when you have this genetic disorder, not every cell is affected. You'll have some normal cells, 46XX, and some abnormal cells, 45X, where you're just missing an X. So those patients tend not to be quite as severe in their symptoms as they present. Or you may be agenesis, where you're totally missing your ovaries. You may also have premature ovarian failure, and I've listed here some of the causes for premature ovarian failure. We've kind of talked about these problems already. Compartment 3 disorder is a pituitary tumor. Or you can have Sheehan syndrome. That's associated with a severe postpartum hemorrhage, where as a result of the postpartum hemorrhage, the pituitary doesn't get a normal blood flow, and it becomes necrotic. And this can be either temporary or permanent. But as you can imagine, it's going to affect hormone production from the pituitary. And then compartment 4 disorders, usually is hypothalamic amenorrhea. And so what you're typically going to see, kind of the picture, is you're going to have low or normal gonadotropins, FSH and LH. You're going to have normal prolactin levels, so you don't have a pituitary tumor. Normal MRI of the pituitary, and the patient had no withdrawal bleeding back in step 1. That's kind of the typical picture that you're going to see. Remember, this is a diagnosis of exclusion. Most common causes for compartment 4 disorders, for hypothalamic amenorrhea, is stress, eating disorders, or weight loss. So I just want to read you something that I thought was funny. This is in one of the textbooks written by Dr. Spiroff on endocrinology. So St. Wilgefortis was a 7th daughter of the King of Portugal. This is around 1000, year 1000. And her father arranged a marriage for her with one of his colleagues in another country. And she had vowed to become a nun, and made a vow of virginity. And because of this, she turned to intense prayer, but she also didn't eat. So she had anorexia. And as a result of having very low hormones, she developed body hair growth. And the King of Sicily, who her father had betrothed her to, changed his mind about marrying St. Wilgefortis. And as a result of that, her father had her crucified. Around 1200, the legend of Wilgefortis spread throughout Europe. And she became a symbol of a woman who had liberated herself of female problems and a protectress of women with sexual problems, including problems associated with childbirth. And indeed, women who wanted to get rid of their husbands, they prayed to her because she had successfully resisted both a father and a potential husband. I thought that was kind of an interesting little story. So what goes on with patients who have weight loss is that they have problems with suppression of GnRH, the gonadotropin-releasing hormone that comes from the hypothalamus that results in amenorrhea. Exercise is usually related to body fat levels as well as just the effect of stress. There's increased cortisol that suppresses GnRH. When we talk about treatment of amenorrhea, of course, it's going to be directed at the underlying cause. You know, whatever we've just been talking about is going to be directed at that underlying cause. With infertility, ovulation induction, we've talked about PCOS, we've talked about obesity, and premature ovarian failure may need to have hormone therapy. So our case, we have this 18-year-old college freshman, presents for her college PE. Her past indicates that she had an appendectomy at age 15, a stress fracture of her right tibia last year. She is on the track team and has been running competitively for 5 years. Menarche was at age 13, and her periods were regular for the next year. She states that since she started running, her periods have become irregular, with her last period occurring 6 months ago. She weighs herself daily, and if her weight goes up by a pound, she cuts back on food intake. So amenorrhea for 6 months, she's a runner, she weighs daily, she's already had a fracture, a stress fracture in her leg. So these are some of the typical patient presenting with amenorrhea. Physical exam, her vital signs were normal, but her weight was 105 at 5'6", so her BMI was 16.9, which according to our standard is below normal. Her teeth were slightly worn. She had worn dental enamel, and that can be associated with poor nutrition, you know, not getting enough of calcium and other good nutrients in the diet. The rest of her exam was all normal. So the main thing, though, was low BMI. So what further questions do we need to ask this patient? What diagnostic tests would you perform, and how would you manage this patient? So I want to know her dietary habits. I would do a 24-hour recall today. I want to also know if she's taking any medications, because some patients will try to keep their weight low through use of laxatives or diet pills. She may purge as a way of keeping her weight down, and evaluate her level of food restriction. I'm probably going to refer her to a specialist regarding nutrition counseling, somebody who is used to dealing with anorexia. To regulate her menses, we know that increasing weight would be helpful. Decreasing her training would also be helpful. If that's not a possibility for her, putting her on oral contraceptives that contain estrogen. She may also need to be on calcium and vitamin D. With a stress fracture, she may also need to be on medication to help build bone mass, like bisphosphonate, you know, like Fosamax would be another idea. And that is it for this presentation. Thank you so much for your attention today. You will have the opportunity to ask questions by sending the questions to this email, and I will address those. Thank you very much.